unless you've been living under a rock, the issue that many are near hysterical about is that atmospheric temperature is supposedly going up because humans are producing too much carbon dioxide.
Right.
And if temperature goes beyond a certain threshold, it'll be catastrophic for life on Earth. That's called anthropogenic global warming.
Whoa. Can you say that one again?
It's anthropogenic, means man-made.
Okay, man-made. In 1860, the amount of CO2 in our atmosphere was approximately 285 parts per million,
okay,
or 0.029%. Now, as of 2020, it was 410 parts per million, or 0.41%. So that's just under 50% increase over 160 years. And the current rate of increase is about 2 parts per million per year.
Okay, meanwhile, the planet has warmed by about 0.8 degrees Celsius since 1880. But half of this occurred before any significant change to the CO2. This graph shows both the man-made CO2 emissions and global temperature changes from 1850 to 2010. The green line shows an increase in man-made CO2, most of it since 1940, you can see. The black line shows fluctuations in overall temperature. Now notice that the rate of temperature increase from 1860 to 1880, when there was relatively little man-made CO2, is about the same as for the most recent period when emissions were about 60 times higher.
Interesting.
Now also note that there were dips in temperature at times when CO2 emissions were still going up.
So the increase in temperature cannot be entirely due to man-made CO2.
No.
Now that's not to say, you know, it isn't a factor, but it's just maybe not the most significant one.
Right.
Human contribution to CO2 emissions by burning fossil fuels accounts for less than 5% of the total global carbon budget. I mean, other factors include things like changes in land use, deforestation, volcanoes, CO2 release from the oceans as they warm, the breakdown of organic remains such as dead wood and forests, and, you know, other factors like that.
Like, even assuming if all of the 2 parts per million increase in CO2 is man-made, it would take nearly 200 years to double the level to 800. So why panic?
Like, right.
Why panic? One question for activists is, why not focus on the biggest CO2 contributors like China and India? In 2018, for example, China generated almost 1,000 gigawatts of electricity from coal. The United States was only 261, and Australia, for example, had 36. China and India are planning hundreds more coal-fired power stations. Australia, for example, accounts for only 1.2% of the world's emissions, but like other Western nations, they're targeted by activists far more than China. I mean, it's not that Western nations shouldn't reduce emissions.
Right.
But shouldn't the protests be focused on the biggest offenders,
you would think? You'd think so. There's also something fishy about the infamous hockey stick graph.
Yes, there is.
The graph shows that after a 1,000-year period of relatively stable temperatures, there was a dramatic spike within the last century, particularly in the last few decades. Now, this is usually attributed to the use of fossil fuels. However, this graph has been shown to be fraudulent.
Yes, yeah, it doesn't record either the medieval warming period or the Little Ice Age from the mid-1300s to about 1885. When we add those back, the graph should look more like this, showing fluctuations in global temperatures before any increase in man-made CO2 emissions.
Well, you know, it's said that a picture is worth 1,000 words.
Yes.
Well, the image of that fraudulent graph was a fear-mongering tactic that influenced millions of people.
That's right. And the fear it produced motivated people to vote in climate activists. And another major historical event related to climate change happened about 4,500 years ago. Noah's flood covered the earth in water and buried massive amounts of vegetation and animals, turning them into coal and other fossil fuels. Nearly all of today's coal was formed from the vegetation buried during Noah's flood. The huge amount of buried vegetation suggests that pre-flood CO2 levels must have been very high compared to today levels. CO2 is plant food.
Right. Even secular geologists agree that ancient Paleozoic CO2 levels were much higher, like even 15 times more than
they are today. Yeah. Way higher.
Yeah, there's no evidence that the Earth was, you know, cooked by this situation of, you know, a runaway greenhouse effect or something. The much higher CO2 levels would boost plant productivity and also allow for much more animal biomass.
CO2 is plant food, and more of it would actually be a good thing. A 2017 paper in Nature indicated the increase in CO2 is responsible for 30% of the world's biomass production over the last century. Wow. That's food for both animals and people.
With more CO2 in the air, plants spend less time with their leaf pores open,
right,
losing less water so they can survive in drier climates.
Mm-hmm.
Increased CO2 is causing the greening of deserts.
Wow.
Meanwhile, here in Canada, the government refers to CO2 as a pollutant. Mm. And as in some other countries, it's enacted a carbon tax.
Pollutant? Try living without it. We'd all die. The pre-flood world had up to 15 times the amount of CO2 as now. And vegetation flourished. That's where fossil fuels came from. As the vegetation of the pre-flood world was buried during the flood, it was then converted into coal and oil. The burial of much carbon in the ground has resulted in the CO2 drought that we are in.